All right. I'll let gentlemen sit down and then get started. I'm starting at 12:04. I know the time Nazis that you guys are, just that I get that 4 minutes slack. So I know the sitting is smiling. Okay, all right. Good morning. Say good morning, man.
How difficult is that? One more time.
Okay, so interaction designs, do some downs to my talk. I have like about 40 minutes to go with you guys. Before I get started, let me ask how many people call themselves designers in this room? Calling yourself, you don't need to.
Come on, the hands need to go up more. Everybody's a designer in its own right.
Let me see all the hands go up. You're all developers, right? And some right, we are all designers, ain't it? Cool. So today I'm going to present a session called Interaction Design Do's and Don'ts. It was actually a very politically incorrect, irreverent take on how design gets translated on the web. Okay, so this talk is not about stuff that you would learn at a place like NID. I'm not going to give you like high details of theory, but it's a very practical oriented, life experience oriented situations as to what people tend to do in interactive design and what people could have done differently. Question number one, what is, in your opinion, is interaction design? Can somebody define it to me? Anyone, yeah? Don't be shy. Yes. Okay, Kim, go ahead. Yes. Brilliant, exactly. So interaction design is unlike your graphic design or your print poster design, it has got an aspect that somebody is going to interact with what you are designing. That is the reason why interaction design is a far tougher concept to understand and get it right compared to other design. So on that note, let me introduce myself. My name is Harish. I am the random web guy at Adobe. I get paid to actually go and speak at conferences and con people to believe that I'm intelligent. So that's what I am. I'm also a musician. I play for a band called Agam. That's a Twitter name for that. And this is very important. I'm an overall nice guy. So whether or not how the session goes, you're all going to like me, yeah? Because I'm the nice guy. Right. Okay. So let's get started. All of us agree this, right? Design is subjective. All of us agree to this. It even has
font.
Huh? See, that's what. What font? Well, it's actually pink in color. Think about it.
Don't get me started.
Right. See, that's it. That's what. So design is subjective, and most of the things that I'm saying are subjective to me. Right? If you don't agree with me, say that to me. It doesn't really matter. Like similarly, what I'm going to say, some things you don't agree with me, doesn't really matter to me, because that's the essence of actually doing it. But certain things can be patronized, and that's exactly what I'm trying to put forward in this session. So, ever heard of human interfaces? Everybody talks about this in several respects. See, I don't really understand the real technical halagu of what human interfaces is. But most of the times I've seen people replicating human behavior on interfaces. Can you give me an example?
Red bus showing an Excel sheet when you say these are what?
Anybody from Red bus here? No, I think. Okay, that's one. Anybody else? See, for me, I'll tell you, the most annoying human behavior application that I have seen, in my opinion, is showing an analog clock to show time on a web page. With the second needle ticking in an animation. It could be a GIF, or it could be like an SVG, it could be a flash animation. The next one is the most annoying thing I have is the page flip effect that a lot of flash guys have built through their lives. Instead of scrolling the damn thing, you have to actually flip the page, move the mouse to the middle of the page, and it will slowly animate and change over. That's human behavior, I agree, but that's freaking annoying. I hate it. But there are people who like it, people are still using it. That's fine, but I hate it. So, in my opinion, certain human behaviors should not be replicated on doing stuff for the web. You have to actually reflect what humans do, given a particular condition. What do you do post with something? And how do you translate that into an interface is actually what defines how you do good interaction design. So directly transporting all physical aspects that you do in life into web will actually result in really disastrous results. So that's the reason why I call out very simple demand trends. It's actually a mutated term of commandment that every interaction designer should follow. And my experience does not come as a graphic designer. I am not a qualified UI UX guy, but what I really am is a guy who actually worked with several large scale projects with designers, with developers in large companies in not so easy conducive situations. So what really happens is designing becomes a mundane, cumbersome,
exercise as opposed to an artsy process that it needs to be. So, make things beautiful. Anybody knows who those guys?
Yeah, I think.
So,
who is he?
This is Steve Rajendra, the T. Rajendra. We keep him up here.
Yeah.
He is the most beautiful thing I've seen in very recent times. Look at him, yeah? Right, so why do I say this? You know, why do you need anything beautiful? Beauty is again a subjective condition, but why do you need anything to be beautiful? Let me get out from you guys.
To feel good.
To feel good, then?
Connection.
To connect, then? Go on a date.
Make people relate to.
See, the essence of doing an interface design or an interaction design is that whole presentation that you get needs to be beautiful in certain sense. See, it might just blow my mind, it might just look okay, but something just downright ugly looks downright ugly to everyone. Don't you agree that in ugliness, more or less be ugly? See, it takes a lot of heart and soul to create something downright ugly. But as web guys, web programmers specifically, without making much effort, we actually achieve that. See, because most of the times UI is an afterthought. Like, you know, your UI designer is a guy who is generally getting paid. He is the guy who works with rectangles and squares. He does not even know how to declare a variable. But then, taking that in mind, you actually end up building something which looks like Rajendra. But you respect the thing. But the first requirement is make something beautiful. Second one, make things fast and agile. Most of the times what we end up is an Ashish Chandra. He's neither fast nor agile. Right? So, when you're building something, the greatest of piece of software which takes hours to load or hours to manifest is useless. Simple things. See, I really miss the Clearfit talk. I'm a big fan of the Clearfit application, primarily because it works really fast. It's a personal opinion. It's just a simple web page. It doesn't have a lot of graphical elements going into it. And it's really fast, it really works. Third point is, make things really expressive. Really expressive. This point I agree with the guy in the picture. He is the most expressive guy that I've known. From screaming to swearing at the umpires to crying, he has done everything. So sometimes when I think about an expressive person, this guy comes to mind. I'm from Kerala. My heart oozes coconut oil. Right, so considering the fellow Malu man having this right kind of expressions, these are very good example of how you can make things look really expressive. So we'll come to examples, we'll come to thinking points in terms of all these points. And finally, this is my favorite slide. Make things that work everywhere. This guy works everywhere, even in the moon. He's the guy who can split a bullet. Even his brother-in-law can create, sorry, son-in-law can create a song which is viral on YouTube. He just works everywhere. I'm just setting context, okay, this is not my talk. I'm just setting context. See, the five demands are simple. Like, these are things that we already know. We want beautiful things. We want things to work fast. We want things to be expressive. We want things to work everywhere. Now, take a deep breath and think, people who have written software till today, how many times have you thought in this dimension while writing a feature? How many times do we go beyond the unit test? Like, I have several times seen engineers build a login form with a text input, two text inputs, type it, and hit enter, it works. Now the designer will come and write a CSS, ain't it? And if he doesn't write the CSS, what the hell? I still got something working. And eventually, the user will anyway get used to it. The erstwhile IRCTC application was a great example of that. I need to learn, by the way. I have a subtle application. But hell, you have to get used to it, you're not traveling, ain't it? That's how most of the time design is done. And that's exactly what we're trying to accomplish in this guy. I get asked this question to every single place I go as a consultant. Can you make this jazzy? Forget, and I use a lot of profane words in my talks, okay? Anybody who gets offended, just close your ears. But certain things cannot be mentioned without those right FND words. So, what the fuck does this mean? Can somebody explain to me what does making something jazzy mean? Something like that? Blue fuchsia, green red color. Take an application. I want you to consult for me because I have this X application. I want that to be made jazzy. Because I was a flash guy earlier, I used to get put into all sorts of weird situations because I am naturally the jazzy guy, right? I'm the one who spanned the monkey and the monkey jumps. And you win a laptop, right? So I have an answer for this. Yeah? You want Jazzy? Talk to my posterior. That's not design, buddy. You don't want to take an application and make it Jazzy in the name of interaction design. Right? I'll come to certain points where how people make things Jazzy and completely screw it up. And what colors your sidebar? What colors your header? What colors your footer? The first thing that the guy comes to me and says, so how are you going to make the header? How are you going to make the footer? How are you going to make the sidebar? I'm not fucking going to make a header, footer, sidebar. Web design does not start there, right? So how many of you have written applications with headers, footers, and sidebars? Please let me see the hands go up. Don't you at least get people asking, this left side sidebar is looking very asymmetrical. Why don't you throw one on the right as well? Right, then it looks like really symmetric. Haven't you heard the crack several times? You would have. Why do you have to goddamn think in headers, footers, and sidebars when you're actually talking design? See, this is a don't. If you want, if you have to create something with a header, footer, and sidebar, do it, but that's not your start point. Engineers specifically, designers, excuse me, you wouldn't probably do this. But guys who actually dabble in design, the typical programmer who does not have a designer to support them, the easiest way to do a project is actually creating a header, footer, sidebar, ain't it? Your manager would think you actually started work. Ain't it? Don't do that. That's not how you start writing applications, for Christ's sake. Content is key, ain't it? That's often read as this. The user can go screw himself. Because all I care about is the content. Like, you know, if I have my entire content goddamn laid onto the page in whatever way, if nothing works, you use Ctrl F. Ain't it? Ctrl F works really well. It's a browser feature. Who are you? Bloody user, don't fuck yourself. Right? So, don't do that. So when you're actually building something around the content, your biggest benefit, the biggest challenge for you as a developer designer is to actually present the content. And that's where interaction design comes to place. How does a person interact with your content? It is not by putting it like an RFC. It is not about putting it like a, let me not get started. So, you know, why can't we follow like very simple life steps in interaction design? Be simple. Be polite, be available, be responsive. These are things that you do in real life, right? You actually go and stand in a railway ticket booking counter, you will follow all the four. That's how you get a ticket. So let us look at a simple example of how a web page, a simple text on a web page can be simple and overly complex. By clicking on this checkbox, you can remember your password. Option 1, remember me. Option 2, which one is nicer? The first one. Second one, why is it nicer? Does it convey what it has to convey?
Yeah.
Does it? It does, right? Be polite. Incorrect password on alert. You like it? I don't like it. Who are you telling incorrect password? I want to go on the side bit. I was just trying your pretty software. Don't tell me incorrect password. I hate you. I'm going to tell the right password now. You just say, did you forget your password? That was incredible. You want to try again? Be a little polite. Right? That helps. I'm speaking purely in terms of simple text that we put in web pages or web applications. This is not even speaking about, like, you know, color ergonomics or size of your buttons or, you know, what kind of information safety you have. I'm not talking about all that jazz. I've got a talk for that. And I'm not qualified to talk about that. I'm talking about simple life stuff that I get and hide on the web. Be available. What do you mean be available? Can you tell me what is being available? It's not high availability clusters. I'm not that into that. What is be available in terms of web? Can somebody give me a guess? Well, it will be available soon. No, what I mean, but it's actually a little profound thought. So, being available is something which we actually look at in a little detail when we actually speak about, you know, the principles of proximity, principles of grouping, and things like that. When you actually work on a page, you want stuff that you want to work with, you want stuff that you want to interact with.
to be available for you without you having to make an effort to go and find where. A classic example, I want to screenshot it, but the site has always put it in work, IRCTC. I want to go to Tatpa and make it every morning. So have you, anybody has used the IRCTC site? Yeah, I'll just go into it. So there is this interesting feature where you actually search for something, it will actually search and show a list of trains, and the top right it will actually show a list of seats. Then you click that, then you have to come down and click. It's like a bloody labyrinth. I have to like be a PhD on the page to understand where to click what to do that. The same way if you look at clear the brain looking side, it actually does easy when I actually pull up the website. And finally, be responsive. You click a button. Yeah, screw you. See, most of the times I don't believe that small little progress circle that many on the website show, right? They're not doing shit. I don't think they're doing anything, but they're still there because it actually tells you that some shit is happening. I think it will give you a timeout alert just like the other page. If it's got a timeout, it's going to timeout here also. It's not like because you put up any progress bar, it's not going to timeout, everything's going to work. But put that, got a feedback. So you actually, the user actually gets a response. And responsiveness has also another feature. Like, you know, you do something, get something, instantaneous feedback. Use etc. Like, you know, do more stuff on the client. Like, you know, actually, work on stuff that will actually work pretty quickly on the client side. So that is something to think about. And do pattern disruption. Use of physical metaphors are sometimes good. Sometimes they are not. The not we mentioned earlier. Can you tell me one physical metaphor that has been applied to interaction design? A simple one that we are all very familiar with. Touch. 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 Which one? Can't hear you, sir.
Sorry, sir.
No, sure, it's okay.
I got a question from
you. No, I'm just asking what physical metaphors have you transferred into. Touch is one.
Toggle button switches.
Toggle button, brilliant. What else? Calendar? Calendar? Calendar pop-up? It's not a physical metaphor, but it's something physical. Like you're used to seeing dates in the calendar, isn't it? But what is probably not useful is the stuff that I mentioned, you know, showing actually an analog clock.
Checkbox
on. That's a physical metaphor. Right, you tick to actually agree and you cross to disagree. Good point. So nice to see such a young man sitting in a web conference. Awesome. So, pattern disruption is critical. You know, pattern disruption, like you rightly mentioned, you know, the iDevices actually have that nice little toggle switch and you can actually snap. So, we'll actually look at this in a little bit of detail. Some examples that I wanted to let you guys point. Swipe versus scroll. I want to open this out for an opinion generation. How many of you guys like to swipe vis-a-vis scroll? Who likes swipe? Brilliant answer. Depends on the application, absolutely. But let's say it is applicable to both. Would you like to swipe or would you like to scroll?
Depends on the medium.
Depends on the medium. Let's say it's a touch com. Let's say it's a touch medium. It's a swipe on this. So. Right, so this left to error, this won't scroll, but I'm running OS X line. So theoretically to scroll here, I swipe as well. I just flick my hand on this thing, right? Swipe versus scroll. People are now preferring swipe. Why do you think it is more preferred? Because it comes from something which we are so used to doing. See, instead of flipping like this, you flip a page like this, it gives a similar metaphor, but it's actually much better translated. That's what I call reflection of human behavior. See, everybody likes to swipe, and it doesn't implement it, right? That's what it works. Drag and drop versus double click is the next one. Which one do you prefer on a web page? Drag and drop, why? I want to ask why. What do you think double click is faster?
Double click is faster.
See, this is exactly what I wanted to do with this talk. So how many of us actually think you want to do double click as opposed to a drag and drop? I want to see the hands. How many of you think you will drag and drop and not double click?
It depends, but what the application of drag and drop is the most painful. Drag and drop is much more.
Exactly. So again, you know, I see the point, but why I'm doing this is like speaking web in general. Like, you know, so this is where you actually start making decisions. I've come to two of the points. So
Like Kiran, very appropriately called out. I think what he has called out in the last two answers is what you need to keep in mind. Because web technologies let you drag and drop, or because certain technologies allow you to touch or swipe, that is not the way that you get. So you need to evaluate what medium you are and what application are you building. Sometimes even, sometimes I've seen people actually doing shopping cart applications with drag and drop. Like, you can drag items into a cart by swiping. I, for one, at a personal level, I would like to just click a button and add a cart.
Not even double click, single click.
Just a single click on an icon is actually much better. I actually have a demo which demonstrates what nonsense is this, man?
Yeah.
I don't know how screens, I didn't even go. Yeah, never mind. Scroll versus page speed, we already spoke. In context versus modal. Showing a dialog box to tell you something versus showing it in proximity to the control that you're interacting. Which one is better? Modal?
Yes.
Modal is always better? Again, notwithstanding the application that you're considering, I want to see which one is better. I'm asking is just trying to understand what your answer is as to how you need to think as interaction designers. I know that it is specific to application. If you actually know that it's specific to application, I'm glad. But this talk is because I see several people who do not think like that. See, I have seen a lot of people simply doing drive and drop because it's possible. That's the reason why I have this talk. See, if you're actually going to come back and say and take the same stance that, you know, which one is applicable, I will do. If we were that good, there wouldn't be so many bad applications on the internet to start with. If we were all that very diligent and positive about doing design. So don't fool me on that. We actually don't think that much. That's the reason why I'm even coming forward and taking a talk, which is purely on opinions. I'm not teaching you anything technical here. I knew the risk of doing that in a conference like this, but I still braved it because I want to get the perspective of what the world thinks in terms of doing that. Right? So in context is useful in certain situations, but doing in context everywhere is not a good idea. That's why it is put as versus. Like, you know, you need to weigh which direction that you want to take when you actually do. See, for example, let's take when you actually do a model, when you want to actually stop user interaction on anything, right? I have seen several instances where warnings are shown as model logs. Day before yesterday, I was building an application for a client of mine where I went as a consultant. They were actually showing all their warnings as model dialogues, simply saying that that is our architecture. We have built this great interface inheritance system where everything has been abstracted away into a pop-up, and then you start doing it. Right, so. Verbose versus concise. Not always. Right? Concise for like a forgot password icon, verbose for an instruction. But what really happens is somebody follows a verbose pattern, they don't even think about it. They actually put verbose all across. Right? You know, for the simplest of simple things, you actually have yellow colored boxes with a lot of text going into it. Haven't you seen that? See, it is actually an interaction designer's job to actually build an interface which has actually got a combination of verbose versus concise descriptions, graphic elements. Sometimes you need a button with just an icon. Sometimes you need a button with icon and text. Right? See, what I commonly see is that it is always an icon with text. Because somebody's going to walk up to you and say that, I don't understand what this icon is. So where is that balance coming? You need to actually see that balance. Anybody building enterprise applications here? Enterprise apps? People who actually build banking software, insurance software, and things like that. Two people, I have a question for you, sir. Isn't this a common challenge that you face?
Yeah.
Because you, as a designer, the designer might want to build a combination of infographics and icons and things like that, but you have a small real estate to actually convey a lot more information. So that is the place where you need to actually sit back and think how you're going to do your design in terms of where you're going to weigh your verbose design aspects and where you're going to weigh your concise design aspects.
Sometimes the tool tips are very helpful. Like,
yeah, so tool tip is one way of doing it. Actually moving up again, tool tips are a big problem in touch devices because they don't really have an inherent mouse over activity. So something to keep in mind, instruction versus suggestion, which one do you like?
Suggestion.
Yeah, we like suggestion, but sometimes you have to instruct, sometimes you have to suggest. Are you thinking that way when you're doing instruction design? Are you separating your design aspects into which portion falls under instruction, which portion falls under suggestion? Have you been thinking about it that way? Many of us have not been. And we actually do a mixture of both. We actually instruct at a place where we actually have to suggest, and we actually suggest at a place where we need to instruct. So that is something you need to think. Panic versus reassurance. Always reassurance, isn't it? When do you give panic? Your credit card has failed, it's panic. You cannot reassure them. Hey, you know what? Your credit card has failed, congratulations. I will be happy to use your credit card. You actually put a panic notion there, correct? You actually say your payment did not go through, do something about it. So something like, did you forget your password? Would you panic? You wouldn't. Looks like you forgot your password and reassure that person. Right? So you don't just about the text. There are visual ways of showing panic and visual ways of showing reassurance. So visual way of showing panic is actually showing a red colored bar on top, actually putting a danger sign, or actually showing like a alarm board. Why? How would you do reassurance? Have you thought about it? How would you reassure a person when he's actually not doing something correct? I didn't hear you. Who said that?
Have soft colors.
Colors, of course. Beyond colors, what do we do? Just start to think. Would you actually give options? Would you actually bring in relevant context that would help them actually overcome the problem? 404 page is very helpful. Anything? No. So, panic versus reassurance is an interesting interaction design challenge, primarily in enterprise applications, because enterprise applications have complex workflows, and most of the times what I get back, anybody uses a software called Concur here? Concur? Isn't that a panic-driven website? Every single error will actually induce severe panic in you. Something terribly went wrong is an error message that I get when I actually not uploaded a receipt. Right, so it fails in the context that the designer, the interaction designer has failed to capture the user in terms of what he really has to do. All I know is I have to panic now. And I really don't know how to fix it. So sometimes in situations where you have to absolutely panic, but most of the situation can be solved by reassuring the user in terms of what he needs to do when he has actually circumvented the real workflow. Find this subtle and on your face. On your face works when you're actually selling something. A most sober advertisement on a web page. See, for example, Adobe tried it, and because we have a strong brand recall, it's not a perfect deal. White and red actually works, but typically subtle and on your face is actually a huge debated interaction design question. How would you design an interface? Would you do a dark on light or light on dark? How many of us prefer light on dark? Dark on light? Majority of the world prefers dark on light. So I was part of a project called the Adobe Media Player a long time ago. It was a version 1.0 product which I was the designer and developer for, and we built a light on dark application, which of course did not resonate with the people who actually watched videos, even though Windows Media Player is a white on dark application which a lot more people use. So the thing about building color scheming and or building your icon types or building your buttons or building a typography, you need to have a concept preset. You cannot have an application which has got orthogonal contrast between subtle and on the face. If you're actually taking a subtle to on the face approach, you actually have to gradate. You cannot have two different aspects of the same application. Whatever your business requirement is to have both the characters coming together. It is a very, very difficult problem to solve. So this is something which you need to consider while you are doing interaction design. So don't think that I'm going to build a white, and again, in enterprise, white and blue is the color scheme most of the times. So it is a very safe option. Like, you know, so we want to build a website, white and blue, right? Like now that Facebook also does it, it's pretty authorized that white and blue is the way to go, which is something which is serious and boring. So it's the enterprise application that typically boring. Sorry about this. So that is something to keep in mind. Principles of grouping. Anybody knows what this is? Anybody studied this? Proximity, similarity, and common fit are the most common ones applicable. There are more. These are the most common ones applicable to doing interaction design for the web. Proximity is actually grouping things that are similar to each other together, that your eye naturally perceives the related actions together. But these things can be heterogeneous. Right? This could be a combination of different actions, but when they are put in close proximity, they make sense. While similarity is grouping similar things together. What is the difference between proximity and similarity? Has a very small but a very pertinent difference. See, proximity, a good example of proximity is if I click this and I show a toolbar right next to it, which has got everything pertaining to styling this text field put inside that toolbar. That's an example of proximity. See, everything that is put together. While similarity is a set of similar things. Like, you know, it could be a homogeneous, heterogeneous combination of things which can actually come together and work. And what is common fit? Common fit is usually applied in animations. Like, when you actually swipe something, or when you actually transition from one view to another in an Android application, the whole UI slides past and the new UI comes in. So this can be compared to how you perceive a fleet of birds. You don't perceive it as one bird flying to you. When you actually see a huge fleet of birds, you'll actually perceive it as a group motion, like a fleet. The same way, if you're actually doing motion, you actually need to be careful in terms of how you are perceiving or creating that motion. Something which Flash developers, the bad ones, made a huge mess out. They had general flying elements on screen. Like, because animation was possible, things used to randomly fly around. I have an example of that. So that is a place where you need to actually sit back. If you're actually going to introduce motion and animation, you need to think and actually have a common fit situation to be able to use it. Sorry, I don't have a screen saver. I don't know why it's broken. Movement has meaning only in common fit situations. Otherwise, movement is typically annoying. See, generally things bouncing around or jumping around or animating is annoying. And the technology which I used to represent earlier, the technology called Adobe Flash, I used to be an evangelist for the technology that got a lot of flack from the general world primarily because there was completely thoughtless, mindless use of animations and movement, which then it did not have a real common fit configuration. Something to keep in mind. Thin line between meaning and annoyances, transitioning views, and skip intro from languages. The first one means meaning, the second one is pure annoyance. So, again, going back to my first point of making it jazzy, most of the people actually throw animations. Even today, I was actually flabbergasted to see a GIF animation running on a web page yesterday because it was considered jazzy. Don't do that. Bad design and bad engineering are technology agnostic. You can create bad shit with anything. So please remember that when you're actually doing something, you're actually creating something, and you're actually creating shit, it probably means that you've sort of done something like ridiculously bad. And after you're fixed, you'll have to go back and bring technology. Oh, this jQuery mobile is so patchy and slow, my transitions are so bad. Have you actually looked at your website? Have you written it with your when you comment about Twitter Bootstrap, when you comment about a micro framework saying it's really slow? It might be slow, but have you evaluated your part on it in terms of have you designed it right? Have you programmed it right? And here's an example of that, Exhibit A. This is an HTML5 application, bleeding edge. Now, is this looking terrible because of HTML5? Today, right? HTMLZomba.com, go and check it. It's actually a brilliant example of my previous statement. And the more bigger you should suspect. This is Flash. Clear example of how you should not do design, ain't it? Right? So, I am sort of short in time. Let me quickly move. I have to skip. I will take questions. I have two demos. You can find me outside, I can show them the demos, but I can take questions. For the sake of time.
I have a question.
Sure.
How do you handle desperate customers? Because when it comes to people who are very desperate to use your particular service, they wouldn't really care about the design, where you place a button or anything. The buttons won't really mean anything for them if they're that desperate. So how do you feel with them?
After he's finished with his work, I'll shoot him. Because it is people like that who actually completely patronize and evangelize bad design. Because I'm so desperate, you throw shit at me and use shit. Correct. The point is, the moment the user gets more discerning, he actually gets thrown better things to actually use, you will actually start getting better software. The whole reason as to why we have bad software or bad interaction design is because the user is desperate. IRCTC, great example. I am desperate, I need to go to my wife's place. Wife's place, mind you. I need to buy a ticket, whatever shit they're throwing at me, I'm gonna take it. But so I don't want to handle them. I actually want to correct them or shoot them. Right? Any other questions?
Yeah. So since this is not opinions, I just wanted to ask you and everyone else, like, do you think there is a certain thing called good design in general? Have you come across, like, there would be things that you as a designer would be completely convinced of, and people don't take it, and maybe it's the purpose of design to be intrinsically understood by everyone, but I, in my career, haven't come across something like that. Did you ever come across something like that?
No, I haven't. Anybody else can also chip in? This question is asked also to the audience, not specifically to me. So his question is, have you ever come to see a design which you would intrinsically call great design? Like, you know, is that what the question is?
Yes, so every time you design, there are a set of people who agree, there's a set of people who disagree. You're icon, some people are icon friendly, some people are text friendly, so there's like,
right.
You see it as a common consensus to which people can
right.
come to.
So I don't believe there's 100% consensus. I don't believe there is, but this is from my experience as a person who was built in classic situations of design, not really bleeding edge. I haven't built like bleeding edge web software. I've actually built customary, old-fashioned 90s style web software. My work was to actually bring them to actually give them a web of color. I think this iterative. See, 9 out of 10 designs I actually thought were great. I think all my designs are great. Like, that's how every designer thinks, otherwise you're not a designer. But 9 out of 10 have actually been failures with respect to the person, to the sampling set that I tried it. But what I realized is, like, if you iterate and actually sample sets of people, because design is primarily targeted at a specific audience that you're going after. No software is extremely generic and democratic. Like, every software has its audience. So if you iterate within that audience and actually understand the points of that audience, you will actually arrive at something which is better than most of the functional ones and still at that 80th percentile. That is my belief. But if you ask me, is there a perfect design that somebody's gonna completely latch on? I am not the holistic expert to comment on that. So I actually blame it on my own personal expertise of not having that. So somebody who is actually from the UI side of things in the room, I'll be happy if somebody can actually take the question.
So my is that unless you build it for a single person, there's never going to be 100% design.
Theoretically, I would agree. Yes, I have a question. Oh, you want to answer him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it is better if we characterize our audience. We identify the characters which are our audience, and then we characterize the situation. In which situation your product is going to be used by a user?
Yeah, the whole personas thing and workflows, everything is there in place. But every time you design, you know who you design, but eventually enter.
Personas are always hypotheses, yeah?
Yes.
See, personas are a belief of a person. See, personas
yeah.
work, I have nothing against personas. Every project has. Personal allocations, but anybody with your experience, you'll realize that personas are only hypotheses. So when your persona fails, the easiest excuse is to say my persona was wrong. You would never say that what I ended up building is wrong, right? Persona is an easy way to actually escape, right? I'm going to take the remaining of the questions. A small word of flipping over here. This is an impressionist specification. It's created using a tool called Impressionist. Impressionist is a tool that I built, which is a visual authoring tool for InteriorJS presentations. You can actually go check that at hexagram.com/impressionist/alpha3. It is also open source on GitHub. It's something that I'm building, so you don't want to write a lot of HTML, JavaScript, CSS to build InteriorJS presentations. So please go and check it, fork it, log bugs, or use it for your projects. Okay, hang on. This is my next talk, I'll show you my card next. So. That's my coordinates. I like what Haskeet uses, dollar beverage of choice. Isn't that what you guys use? I like that one. So beer is my beverage of choice. So anybody who wants to hang out or, you know, virtually, that's my email address. That's what I'm on Twitter. I have a bunch of projects on GitHub, mostly on web and open standards, and that's my blog. And another shameless plug before you guys all go away. After lunch, I have a talk over here, which is not an opinion talk, it's a technical talk. I'm trying to cover Canvas and SVG face-to-face and see which way should you actually go while building your web applications. If interested, please do come back here at 2 o'clock and I'll see you guys. Have a nice lunch. Thank you very much.